Hello everyone. Thank you very much for joining us. We're just going to wait a minute or two while we have some more people join. Yeah, so just hold on. We'll be starting in a minute or less. We've got 160 people on. I think let's crack on now, and hopefully a few more will come in. It's great to see so many people here, so thank you very much for joining us. So my name's Phoebe Weston. I'm a biodiversity reporter at The Guardian, and this is a webinar about meadow restoration in the UK. This is the second talk organised by Pasture Fed Livestock Association, the PFLA, and Plant Life, looking at the theme of species-rich meadows and grasslands. Today, we're looking at how people can protect and restore them. So this is focused on farmers and people doing it in large scale. In September, so our next webinar is going to be about people who are looking to do it in gardens and verges in smaller scale restorations. So PFLA is a membership organisation of farmers, many of whom are managing species-rich grassland, and Plant Life promotes the restoration of these very important habitats. So we're going to split today's webinar into two parts. The first, so it's going to be probably an hour and a half long. In our first webinar, we had 90 questions and about 5 or 10 minutes to answer them. So we didn't get very far. So now we've extended that, we've got 45 minutes. So hopefully we'll get onto as many of your questions as possible. We're also going to have some people from PFLA and Plant Life on hand to type answers to questions as we go along. So if you put your questions in the Q&A section, as opposed to the chat, that'd be great. And all of our speakers today are going to be on hand to answer questions. So if you want to direct your question to a specific person, then do say who it's for. We've got a lot to cover, so hopefully our panelists will be to the point. I know, and yeah, as I say, we'll have lots of time for questions, so hopefully we'll cover a lot of ground. So we're going to start with Plant Life talking about setting the scene on different meadow restoration techniques. And we have Phoebe Miles, who's project manager for Magnificent Meadows in Wales, and Matt Pitts, who's a meadow advisor. And then we're gonna go to our three PFLA farmers. So we've got Ollie Walker in Devon, who's produced a video of his large scale introduction of green hay into some of his fields. And then we're gonna hear from Bill Grayson, who farms in Cumbria. And hear about how he's introduced diversity through bale grazing over the winter. And finally, we're gonna hear from Fidelity Weston in Kent, who's gonna look at three different methods that were trialed at Rumshed Farm in Kent over a 10-year period. So let's crack on with Phoebe and Matt to start with.
Brilliant, thank you. Phoebe, do you wanna just say a few words while I get my presentation sorted?
Yeah, just to say that we're going to take the approach of presenting, I guess, the meadow restoration principles and then hand over to those who have done it, mainly in a farming context, to talk about how they've applied those. So we're going to be quite brief because we really want to hear from those on the ground working in the field on this stuff. But we will also, I'll be fielding some questions here with a colleague. I'll be linking quite a lot of resources on the Q&A to specific questions to try and cover off more content than we might verbally today. So do put your questions into the Q&A. I'll be on those whilst Matt is going through the presentation. Matt.
Thank you very much, Phoebe. Yeah, as Phoebe said, this is kind of going to be a real whistle-stop tour of the kind of the main sort of principles around sort of meadow restoration. And hopefully some of the speakers later on are going to pick up some of the detail, and we'll also pick up more of the detail hopefully in the Q&A as well. So one thing to sort of say right at the outset is that what we're talking about today and what Plant Life is interested in. is the image on the left hand side there, which is native species rich grassland, which is typically sort of permanent pasture, and it's typically a mix of finer grasses and mainly perennial wildflowers as well. Whereas the image on the right there is often what you see on the TV, on the internet, and is often referred to as a wildflower meadow. But if you look a lot closer, you appreciate that a lot of the flowers in there are not technically wildflower meadow flowers. They're annuals, and they're often arable weeds and plants of disturbed ground. So what we're focusing on is definitely the one on the left there. So in terms of sort of key principles, really, I mean, understanding your site is probably one of the main starting points for any kind of attempt at restoration, of grassland restoration. And there are some kind of key things that we would look for and we would try and understand as much as we can. Soil is a key aspect of a site, and understanding the soil, its fertility, the pH is really important. Also understanding a little bit about the land use as well, so the historic land use of a site as well, whether it's been in arable land, whether it's in temporary pasture, whether it's permanent pasture, is an important thing to understand, and what kind of inputs that site might have had as well. It may well have had fertilizer or manure inputs in the past, which will affect the fertility of the site as well. So just trying to get a picture, build a picture and understand as much as you possibly can about a site before you start making any decisions about the restoration process and what might be most appropriate for that site. And that leads on also to the idea of understanding what plants might already be growing in a field as well. Potentially you may already have some positive plants in there, and you may already have some plants that we might consider not so great to start with. So it's just this idea of really getting a handle on what's going on. Yeah, so I mean, one of the first things we would often do on a larger scale restoration is get somebody to test the soil, because as I said, understanding something about the soil is really important. The pH and the soil type as well, and the fertility are all going to affect what is possible. So having that sort of basic understanding is really going to guide what you do and the potential restoration and the kinds of species that you might be able to restore and the kind of grassland community that you might be able to create in a particular location.
Matt, sorry to interrupt. Things,
yes.
Could you just come slightly closer to your microphone?
Okay.
Thank you.
That's all right. So one of the key things is understanding the nutrients in the soil as well. And we generally want to look at the phosphorus index. So typically, if we're looking at a restoration site, we're ideally looking for a phosphorus index of probably a 3 or below. Bearing in mind that there are some sites across the UK where there are higher phosphorus levels and restoration has been possible. But I guess we generally want people to have the best success. So we're trying to sort of err on the side of caution. Ultimately, wildflowers generally work best in lower nutrient situations. So the other sort of aspect of this understanding of site is also trying to record what's already there, because if you're starting with a piece of grassland, whether it be temporary grassland or maybe it's a piece of grassland that's been allay for longer than that, you may find that there are some species in there already that might be of some value. So getting an understanding of that is a really important sort of starting point and a basic principle as well. Partly because we want to be able to judge the success of a restoration as we go along. So, you know, if we're planting or trying to encourage or plant certain, spread certain flower seeds in that meadow, we want to know whether they have actually grown and germinated in that meadow. So getting a sort of baseline understanding of what's already there is really important. The other aspect of that is also thinking about some of the negative plants that might be a problem for restoration. So some of the sort of more perennial weeds, getting an understanding of how many of those might be in a meadow before you start restoration or in another, you know, in a piece of land, because they can cause problems later down the line. So we generally want to try and understand that too, and then try and deal with those before we do any restoration. So yeah, just a little bit more on that in terms of some sort of positive, I mean, what we would, I suppose what they're termed in an ecological sense is a positive indicator. So on the left-hand side there, you've got some of those plants might be in an existing piece of grassland, they may not be, but again, they will give you a bit of an indication as to what's happening in that place. and they are often the ones that you would probably want to introduce depending on the soil type. So we've got a couple of positive indicators there, yellow rattle, often not found in improved pasture, and often not in semi-improved pasture, but often in the better species rich grasslands. But birdsfoot trefoil is a plant that's a generalist flower and often can be found in small quantities in some of these meadows before restoration. But just getting an understanding of this really helps you to work through it. And then on the other side there, we've got some of the ones that we would consider problem plants. And particularly the process of restoration is generally creating some sort of soil disturbance. So of course, what that's going to do potentially is going to unlock and unleash a seed bank of some of these more negative plants. So we have to be really careful about that before we start restoration. So trying to lower the weed burden on a site is a really important sort of key principle. And potentially you'd certainly do that before any restoration, and you'd normally be going around and spot spraying or pulling those kind of weeds. So sort of moving on to the sort of techniques that we would sort of advocate really for restoration. I think as a starting point, we would always explore the opportunity for natural seeding techniques. And when I say natural seeding, that's really about trying to find a suitable species rich meadow in the vicinity of where you're trying to create or recreate your meadow, and use that as a donor. So in effect, we may collect seed or we may collect green hay from that meadow and then transfer it to the meadow that you're trying to restore or recreate. So the images there on the screen really just give you an idea of some of the different techniques. The top three from left to right and to the bottom there are all examples of people brush harvesting seed from a existing species-rich meadow, which is then going to be used and broadcast on this receptor meadow. The bottom left there is green hay being collected again from a species-rich meadow that's then going to be spread out as part of the restoration process. And I think these ideas are going to get picked up later on down the line. I know Molly's going to talk more about the sort of the process of green hay and how you transfer material from one site to another. I guess one of the main, or at least some of the main benefits as well to doing this approach, this natural seeding approach, is that we're trying very hard to try and preserve the local character of meadows, because they vary up and down the country. So trying to find a meadow in the locality on the right soil type that matches your meadow. So of course, understanding about the geology and the soil type is really important, because that helps you to match the species and the meadow to what you're looking for. So that's an important aspect, this preserving of local character, which it varies across the country. It's often cheaper to use these types of methods as well. Generally, plants that grow in a locality are better suited to the soil and the aspect and the local climatic conditions as well of a location. And I think there's an increasing sort of body of evidence as well that suggests that native plants are better for the soil and better for livestock as well. So there's some kind of interesting stuff there. So moving on from sort of choosing or getting hold of your seed, we would then look at the actual preparation of the site as well before you do the restoration. So really the key principle here is about the creation of bare ground. And again, experience has shown, I think, across the country over many years, really, that the more bare ground you can create, particularly if you're going to try and restore an existing piece of grassland, which is often the case, you may have a piece of semi-improved grass. So you're not starting with a completely blank canvas, because you may already have some species of value in that meadow. So ideally, we're looking to try and create between 50 and 80% bare ground. Just on the slide here, we've got a variety of different machines that can create bare ground. And probably the top left is probably the most dramatic, and probably the one that does create the most bare ground. But I suppose the reality of this is the more bare ground you potentially can create, the more you're suppressing the grass, and therefore the more likelihood of success of germination in those first critical months of the restoration. So there are a few caveats with that, though. Creating a lot of bare ground, as I said earlier, can also disturb a seed bank of negative weed seeds. So of course, that's why we want to get on top of some of those problem perennial weeds before we start doing any of these kind of more invasive interventions. So again here, so moving on from prep, so this is again some of these natural seeding techniques, how we actually move and spread the material out. So we've got examples there of green hay being spread from the left-hand side there. And then on the right-hand side, we've got seed that potentially may have been brush harvested, but may also be some sort of bespoke seed mix, which might have been put together based on a survey of a donor meadow to try and match the species as best as we possibly can from a native commercial seed mix. But again, we would definitely sort of err on the side of trying to use those natural seeding techniques as our first sort of our starting point. A few things there to just think about. I mean, so key principles really is that green hay has to be moved very, very quickly. Typically, it may well be cut, it may be wilted. So it may be cut one day, left to wilt, and then literally moved the following day without being spread around, because we're trying to capture as much of the seed as possible. We don't want the seed to be lost from the green hay, so it wouldn't be part of a traditional haymaking. We're not trying to spread the seed around. And then it's moved, and then it's spread across that donor site that's been prepared where you've created that bare ground as quickly as possible. So normally within a few hours of being cut or baled, it would be spread. So we've got muck spreader there, and we've got people sort of just doing it by hand. So again, depending on the scale and size of your site, there are different options really. And then we've also got on the top there, we've got a straw chopper, which is used quite successfully for chopping and blowing out green hay as well.
Matt, can I just ask you again to just move closer to the microphone speak up a bit? Thank you.
All right. If you think about, so that's green hay. And then if you're using seed, the key principle really is that the seed will be broadcast on the surface and not buried. So that's a key consideration. And then ideally, you would want to try and get livestock fairly quickly back into that meadow, or you would want to roll it so that you're pressing the seed into that bare ground, so the seed is making contact with the soil, again, to try and aid and speed up the germination process. And then the next aspect really is which is really important to this restoration process, is the aftercare, in that initial few months after you've broadcast or introduced seed into your meadow is about keeping the grass as short as possible and trying to suppress that grass as long as you can through the autumn and the winter. And particularly we know these days that autumn is getting milder and therefore grass keeps growing. So it's trying to keep that suppressed while these small seeds are germinating and give them enough space and enough light. So this is obviously where the whole livestock part of this, you know, is really, really critical to this, particularly to this restoration process, but also to the long-term, you know, management of these species-rich meadows. And then sort of moving on to sort of long-term management, as I said, I mean, grazing is a key consideration. And typically, I mean, meadows tend to sort of break down into two different types of management. You would either manage as a hay meadow with grazing, or you may manage as a pasture with grazing at different times of the year. But grazing is fundamental to making these systems work, I suppose. And it's that regularity of this you know, this annual cycle of management that ultimately over long periods of time is where we get the most species-rich meadows. So just very briefly, these are just kind of diagrams, which I think Phoebe will share more detail of these from the guidance notes that we've got on our website. This is really just taking you through a sort of simplified view of a hay management cycle, but it's ultimately about allowing those flowers to seed and flower, and then taking that crop off and then the aftermath grazing. And I mean, pasture management, I suppose, to some extent is also, I mean, you're just using the grazers as the tool to remove the crop rather than haymaking. But so grazing, you know, so there is a period of time during the summer where you are reducing the grazing or having no grazing at all, and then you're having more extensive grazing, or more, I suppose, intensive, not extensive, you're having more grazing through the late summer and autumn to try and remove as much of that crop as you possibly can. I suspect Bill might pick up a bit more of this hopefully when he talks later on. And sort of then looking forward and thinking about longer term management, I mean, sometimes you do have problems and challenges with some of these perennial weeds, and particularly in the first few years when you've created this disturbance of the soil. So, you know, typically you do need to be on top of the control and the management of these perennial weeds in the first year or so. And again, you've got a variety of sort of techniques and principles there for control of weeds. I mean, spot spraying is often used for most of these perennial weeds. Again, good pasture management and not allowing the field to become overpoached and overgrazed also, you know, so it's really a combination of these different techniques that can help you to control those weeds over a period of time. And then we've got the idea of potentially pulling weeds as well. So, but it's probably a combination of all those things that potentially can help you reduce the weed burden over a long period of time. So that's me just whistle stop tour through some of those key principles. I suppose the thing to just mention at the end here is that there's various bits of support out online. We as an organisation have got a website called Magnificent Meadows. I think Phoebe's hopefully put the link in there. She's put various links into lots and lots of much more detailed technical guidance about all the things I've just whistled through very briefly. So there's loads more information there. Up and down the country, there are lots and lots of different groups, facilitation groups, farmer cluster groups, meadows groups that are also with lots of expertise and knowledge about meadow restoration. Over in Wales, Phoebe is working on a project called Magnificent Meadows Cymru, where there is free support there for farmers and landowners and anybody really interested in meadow restoration. So there's a lot of help out there, I suppose. And I suppose the point to make is you shouldn't just kind of struggle trying to figure this out on your own, because there are people out there that can help and support you with meadow restoration. That's enough for me. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Matt. Are we over to you now, Phoebe, or going to Ollie?
Go to Ollie, yep.
Okay.
I'll continue. Ollie,
over to you now.
Okay, I think we're going to view the film, which we made. Hopefully we can hear some sound on it. Has anyone got any sound? So they'd be patient a minute.
The journey has to start somewhere, and that began with a conversation with actually a Woodland Trust advisor who, whilst walking through one of our meadows, and I was kind of wondering in the beginning days when I took on the farm, what should I do? What direction should I take the farm? And he just said, you know, maybe have a discussion with Natural England and see if you could build a meaningful HLS agreement around these, because there's some nice stuff in your meadows, but it could be better. So I really think you have to build an idea on your farm. You have to look at where your oldest pastures are. For me, these pastures are the furthest pastures away from the farm hub. So they're the sort of outer reaches where it would have been difficult to transport muck and nutrients over the years. Interestingly, I did find plough shears when we did recreate some earth banks. So evidence probably post-war, earth banks had been removed and hedges had been removed and fields had been made a lot bigger. You know, I really consider my farm as a farm of two halves. Half of my farm is locked up in these wonderful recreated meadows that we've worked on since 2017. The other half of the farm is in very diverse herbal lay mixes, which are rotationally grazed predominantly with sheep. So they provide the protein that we need for our lamb crop during the summer months, during the real growing season. And then really they get shut up after tupping in November, December time, and they're left to rest for 4 months until we lamb again. And during that winter period, we would aftermath graze in a rotation our hay meadows. So we have about 50 hectares of hay meadow and about 50 hectares of a rotationally grazed herbal lay platform. And that's just a balance. You know, you could draw a line down the farm and say, well, that's one way of managing, and then we manage the meadows in another way. The hay meadows also support the cattle enterprise. So we've got about 50 cattle on the farm. We're going up a bit in numbers, but we essentially bed and feed our Ruby Devon pedigree cattle on this species-rich, diverse meadow hay. We're not too fussy, you know, the cows will pick through what they don't eat. If they're younger cattle, they also get a better quality silage as well. Yeah, we make forage in July and August on the meadows, and typically we make somewhere between 200 and 300 bales per annum. And we're just finding actually year on year, the later we can cut. I mean, the climate is different every year here. The drought meant that the crop was very thin early on. We had very late frosts into June, which actually knocked a lot of the yellow rattle and other herbs, but we did then have good rain later on in the season, and that bulked the crop up. So we knew that we would want to create about 50 hectares of meadows. So we had a HLS higher level countryside stewardship agreement, which began in 2017. Really, that gave us a wonderful framework, a very prescriptive way to follow. When you take on one of these agreements, I'm sure lots of you are familiar with this, you get a huge wedge of paper, a huge document, which tells you every nuance and way that you should carry out each activity under which prescription. But if you do get into the detail of everything they're telling you and you follow it, it's enormously helpful. And so, you know, the process for us began with sourcing quite a large quantity. We did this 50 hectares, we split it in two and did it over 2 years, so 2017 and 2018. And we took around 55 bales each year onto the farm. The cost of this activity was covered by 100% capital grant within the HLS. So Natural England knew they wanted to work with a local supplier, and they watch very closely the development of that hay crop that year. And then when it's ripe, it's harvested. We helped find a contractor who could work with the kind of speed pace that we needed to, because it was a huge quantity of crop that had to be brought onto the farm, and had to really, within the space of 6 hours from harvest, has to be distributed. So we rotovated our ground initially with a standard arable power harrow that you would use to break soil and create a fine tilth. But if you just set that right a couple of inches into the turf, you can scuffle that turf and break it enough to receive the green hay. See, 50 bales were distributed using four tractors, two K2 rear discharge dung spreaders. So they're quite big. You know, you can distribute green hay through a straw chopper, but my experience is that the crop is quite bulky and wet, and they tend to, not all of them, but they will tend to block up. So, you know, a word of caution, if you do that, you can distribute green hay in small quantities by hand if it's in small square bales. Opted to have ours made in round bales, and then that was distributed. So you need quite a lot of net on your bales if you're going to transport green hay. Extremely heavy. I mean, they'll tip a tractor. They're just wet, and the wetter the better, really. They go into the back of dung spreaders, and then straight away, the same day even, we turned out animals onto those field parcels to trample that seed in, and they would eat any of the green hay that was palatable. Seeds that were within that would pass through them, distributed in a nice dollop of manure. So first year we did it, we had the beast from the east as well, which I think you couldn't have timed it better, because a lot of those seeds within the green hay do benefit from a prolonged period of freezing. And we saw a phenomenal take in the yellow rattle. Certainly that can be helpful to the overall process. And then we grazed quite hard initially to suppress any grass that was growing. We had taken a hay cut the week before, so the grass was nice and short, and the animals were kept pretty hard, pretty tight on those field parcels which had received green hay initially. They were then given a slight break, and then I think we put some animals back in until Christmas time, maybe just for 2 weeks before Christmas, in the first year with cattle. And I think just going gently with those, we had quite a mild period there early on, and I was frightened that seedlings might germinate but then be nipped off, so I just wanted to make sure that they would take and get the best chance they could. You can graze right through till February, I'm told, but I certainly think in the first instance, when you create something and you add new seedlings, that you do need to be delicate with it. Certainly now, 2-3 years on, I'm not worried in the slightest. I will graze from August through till February, even early March. Just depends what the weather's doing. Don't want to annihilate things, but it will help open up the sward. Aftermath grazing with animals will help tread in seed that was dropped by the haymaking process. Obviously, that's our management. For us, we're on an acid grassland, neutral to acid grassland, and we edge on to wet colm measure. Colm grassland is sort of found in North Devon, and it's very much a retreating, you know, through land drainage and stuff, but we're a clay-based soil. We've got anything from a foot of topsoil down to 15 centimetres of topsoil, and then we're onto sort of blue-grey or lias clay, which, unless you've got good land drains, is not porous. So a lot of this region would have been in wet meadows, rush pastures. So just, you know, a few names of things which are in these meadows are things like common catfear, crested dogstail, birdsfoot trefle, heath spotted orchid, early orchids, knapweed, spearwort, lesser trefle, marsh foxtail, meadow buttercups, meadow grasses, meadow foxtail, meadow vetchling, red clover, white clover, ribwort plantain, self-heal, sharp-flowered rush, sneezewort, southern marsh orchid, sorrel, sweet vernal grass, very abundant, woodrush, yarrow, yellow rattle, plenty of that, that helps suppress creeping grasses, Yorkshire fog, betony, pignut, burnet saxifrage, and red fescue. Composition changes through the farm. I think it just depends what the soil's like, what the acidity level's like, what the past management's like. For us, it's early days, but we've got plenty of examples of all of those species on the farm, which is wonderful. Touch on the management of these meadows. You know, if you've got stock or, you know, enter into a hay cutting regime, you should think about what's happening in between times with these land parcels. For me, the year looks something like this. We would be shutting up our meadows early on in the year, depending on the weather and the soil conditions. But from February through till very early April, we would be pulling all animals off, having grazed. We might have an initial grazing in August. We might let them bulk up and grow a bit of a wedge of winter feed through September and October. Certainly later on, middle November, December, January and February, I would be rotationally grazing my hay meadows to open the sward. And when I say rotationally grazing, I would be, in my case, the cattle would probably be in. Our soil, I don't feel it will hold cattle. For me, I would run a mob of about 300 ewes, possibly with some replacement and tups. So it could be about 350 to 400 sheep, and they would probably graze small paddock, no more than 2 acres, and they would not graze those for more than 3 days, and then I would move them on, and then that land would be rested. When I say rested, I mean through winter. It certainly would be like a 90-day rest. So actually the grazing event is very planned and very controlled, and those animals are only really entering that area for 3 days. They may not even come round, you know, they may just graze that meadow once, or that portion of that meadow once, take it right back. So they really are a management tool. You know, the diversity that's here is a testament to that management. Obviously, you know, if you're in an agreement with Natural England, you'll get a grazing calendar or prescriptions which will tell you what class of stock can graze there in what density. So it's important to look at those prescriptions. I'm using electric fencing. For me, it's KiwiTech gear, which is very lightweight, very durable. It all runs off of a small quad bike. We will use electric fencing in mob or rotational grazing. We're acting as a predator by putting an electric fence in. So we're controlling those animals, what they're doing, what they're eating, when they're moving. To the extent that if I get too close to my sheep a day early or whatever, then they just go berserk. So they know I'm coming to move them, and it doesn't take a lot to move them. They're trained, and if you don't have stock that are trained to electric, then I would recommend you experiment a bit and get using a bit of electric fencing, because it can really work wonders for the amount of grass you can grow and also for the diversity. So that would be us through the winter, and then we'd come into a shut up period, which would be 31st of March or 31st of April, depending on which meadow it is, right through to the 15th of July would be the minimum. I mean, we're now the end of July and I still haven't cut. I've cut a tiny portion, but I'm leaving it a little bit later this year. I think there's a window coming this week or next week, but I just want I want as much seed to bulk up and set and be on the ground. So I'm kind of managing them differently as I go. Those meadows will be cut. A nice wide wavy margin is left around the meadows. I think there's like sort of 10% in every field is the prescriptions tell me that must be, you know, minimum, and that should be documented as to what you're not cutting. I certainly will be picking this year areas which are more interesting, or that we want to take a bit of brush seed harvesting of the seed and to diversify other meadow areas. So I didn't say before, we took a leader grant last year and we actually acquired a brush seed harvester. So that's a little quad bike machine which is made by Logic, and essentially it's a brush a brush on wheels that picks up seed from a meadow. So you just go and comb an area and then tip it out on a sheet, spread it out to dry and bag it up and then chuck it out when you're ready. For me, we went into that because we wanted to diversify what we've got more and spread from more species-rich areas across some of the steeper areas in the farm. But also, maybe in future we might be able to have a bit of a diversified enterprise and be offering some of our meadow seed either to Natural England or Devon Wildlife Trust or private individuals who are feeling that they want to recreate or create meadows. So yeah, we're quite serious about that, and we're excited about what that will be like for us. And then obviously when the hay's off and everything's shut up, we might give it a month or a couple of weeks, depends how much rain we have, how things are looking, and then go in with aftermath grazing with cattle and sheep. You know, we'll just be looking how much grass we've got and which class of stock are needing it. There's quite a lot of plantain and clover that's residual and or that comes back quite quickly, I find. And where I've got thinner ewes, I'm finding that it's nice to try and put a bit of weight back on them, more flesh on their backs before they go back to see the tup in November. So also, I think plantain can be quite aggressive, and you can suppress it a bit more light into the base of the sward, and sheep are pretty good at nailing that.
Thanks very much for that, Ollie. Is that you done there?
I think that's plenty of stuff you can hear from me. It gives you an overview of our enterprise. And like I say in the video, it's been a framework to hang our enterprise around. It works quite well. It's a nice balance. It adds a lot of interest to farming, you know?
Yeah,
it's been really great.
Okay, brilliant. Well, I'm sure if you have questions for Ollie, do type them in the Q&A. Really enjoyed seeing those videos of your kids playing on the hay. That looked a lot of fun.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, so
I saw a couple of questions pop up about farm safety, and I'm totally with those people who have those comments. Farm safety is something you really need to take seriously. Don't take any chances. We try not to. But yeah, apologies if I've offended anyone on that. All right.
Okay, great. Thanks, Ollie. So I think now we're moving on to Bill. Over to you, Bill.
Yes, hello, everyone. Presentation to share. It comes up.
Bill, sorry, are you able to turn your volume up or I'll
move a bit closer. Is that better?
Yeah, is that that works for me. Is everyone happy with that?
Okay. You all seeing that?
Yeah.
And okay, so covering a lot of the points that Matt and Ollie have been making, but in a different way. So starting points, you know, we've done quite a bit of meadow restoration over the last 20 plus years. We've never actually started from anything like this, which is improved grassland, plowed, reseeded, fertilized spray, sprayed with herbicides, containing very few species. So basically, you know, we've never had anything quite as challenging as that. More typically, we'd have situations that were described as semi-improved. So basically not ploughed, or not ploughed for a very long time, but still subject to fertilizers and often sprays. This is in the Yorkshire Dales, for example. There's a lot of these very yellow meadows because buttercup is much more resistant to the standard MCPA sprays that farmers use for controlling thistles.
Sorry to interrupt, Bill. And we've got a few people saying on the chat that they can't hear you. Is there any way you could speak louder or turn up your volume?
The volume is up, actually. Is that better?
Yeah, I think so. I'm sure people will tell us if it's not, and I'll have...
I'll need to shout and get nearer, and a combination will hopefully do it.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
All right. And then the third possible starting point is something that's been completely abandoned. And this for us is a fairly typical situation. We're mainly in business as providers of grazing, and nearly always we're asked to do grazing in situations where the land in question has been abandoned, usually because it's difficult to get to or because it has inherent technical difficulties with management. So this was one of the fields that we started with. It has actually, back in the 80s, been ploughed and reseeded. So technically it was improved, but we'd seen it for maybe 10 or 15 years with nothing happening on it. And then suddenly an owner emerged from nowhere and said, would you be able to do anything with this for us? So that's how we took it on. So we have all these, but the common characteristics would be that they're all grass dominated. Often they're full of weeds, and it may be creeping thistle, or it may be docks, or it may be nettles, any of the things that Matt was talking about. Usually there is an excess of soil nutrients because of past use of fertilizers or slurry or whatever. In this case, the phosphate index was 3, I think. So it's right at the upper limit of where you'd want to be in terms of restoring it to species richness. So we've got these various starting points. This is kind of where we generally expect to end up. So it's a nice mix of different wild grasses with a range of wild legumes and wild herbs, none of which are bought in. They're all things that arrive entirely at their own behest based around what we're doing. If we're lucky, we get some much more interesting extras. In some situations, we have bluebells growing in the adjoining hedgerows, and without fertilizers and with late mowing, we find that the bluebells seem inclined to move into the meadow itself, which is really quite interesting and nice. And then in other situations, we may just get something like this northern marsh orchid establishing a new population. So we haven't done anything to promote this. It's just happened by itself. So it's nature taking control. The process, and Matt's described this, is all based on mowing, and it's our only way really of removing any excess fertility. We mow late, and by doing that, we're removing more bulk, so that gets more fertility off the ground quicker, but it's also allowing seeds to be recycled within the crop. So the nutrients... The fertility is removed in the bales. We have rather elderly machinery, about 50 years old, but it keeps going. Because we have so much wet weather in these late hay times, we have to borrow equipment that allows us to make haylage, which is when is hay that hasn't been, you haven't been able to dry it properly because of the weather conditions. So we put it into these little round bales and wrap it up in plastic, and that then will cure it into something that we can still use as feed. And this is about as good as it gets at the moment in terms of restoration up here. And this is a lovely meadow that we started with about 25 years ago. It didn't look very promising at the start, but it's come on really well in the last 10 years. So the other sort of lesson is it takes time. You have to, you know, if you're going to do it this way, you haven't to be in so much of a hurry. So clearly there's been a big increase in the species richness. In terms of yield, I reckon it's about 80% of what it was when we first started. So there is a definite price to be paid in terms of output. There's obviously more flowers, a mixture of legumes and wildflowers. So that will mean more wildlife, more pollinators, more life in the soil, we hope. But there's no escape. There will be a bit less production. We're beef producers, so there'll be the less output from that point of view. Although we would maintain, because of this rather herb-rich diet, the meat itself will be somewhat better in terms of its quality. So we have these two key species, and this is what we look for when we start this process, hay rattle and red clover. And it's interesting the way that they work in opposition to each other. The parasitic effect of the hay rattle weakening the grasses, reducing their vigor, allowing more species to come in. Usually the first thing that goes along with it is red clover, which begins to reverse that process by supplying the whole sward with nitrogen fix from the air. So out of that competition between those two species comes the magic that will eventually make the meadow that we're looking for. You need to start with a good donor site. Now, when we came to the Morecambe Bay area, none of the meadows that we had really any botanical interest other than one small area of hay rattle, which, recognizing its importance, we've carefully nurtured over the years. And my guess is, if you did a DNA analysis on all these different meadows, you would find that the hay rattle is common to all of them, because as we've gone taken on new meadows, this is what we've started with. It all comes from that one little patch of hay rattle at the beginning. So it is an annual. It relies on setting seed every year. So the timing is crucial. This would be too young. If you mowed at this time, you wouldn't get much seed. On the other hand, if you left it that much longer, you still wouldn't get much seed because it's all fallen on the ground. So the optimum is to get something in between. When you've cut the hay and made it into bales and you start to feed it, then you very quickly see whether you've got the timing right in terms of harvesting the seed. There it all is laid out before you. Usually doing it this way, there will be a mix of species, and it's all dependent entirely on which field you're harvesting the crop from. So having secured the seed, we then have to get it into the ground. We have to get it to the fields where it's needed. And this is the method that we use for that. So it's not what I would call bale feeding, I think, which is how it was described. I'm trying to get rid of this label at the top. Okay, so we feed the cattle on the fields where the seed needs to establish. We have to take care to avoid any excessive poaching. So we spread it around a different part of the field every day. We lay it out in small heaps so that they're not all piling into the same area and really causing poaching. One advantage of it is that it's much cheaper because there is no housing. So we escape all those additional costs of having to have a building to put the animals in over winter. I would argue that it's less work because A, they have to be fed anyway, and there's no mucking out. So all the manure that they're producing doesn't have to be gathered up each day, put in a pile, and then taken out onto the fields the next summer and spread. So the manure here is going straight back onto the land, which is ideal for the invertebrates. And admittedly, in the winter, there aren't nearly so many dung invertebrates. We were assured in a webinar a couple of weeks ago that they're still there and they still benefit from it. So we only do this once a day. And the problem there is ensuring that the animals have enough feed for that 24 hours to see them through. We don't want them to go short. So we have to be pretty sure how much they're going to need and that we're supplying the right kind of food that they'll be able to fully utilize. Palatability is key. And there's an interesting point here, because one thing we've noticed is that they don't like these hays and haylages that are made from very grassy fields. What really turns them on is when there's a lot of herb and clover in them. That's what they really go for. So if we're feeding that herb-rich product, then we can see immediately that they really like it, because they stay with the first heaps that they encounter. We carry on putting the rest out. However, if it's the grassier kind of stuff, they don't like it. They're obviously clued up to the fact that we have supplies of the better stuff, and for some reason we're withholding them, so they come chasing after it to see if we've got something better to offer. So that business of supplying the feed in a way that they'll fully utilize, if that's working, then this is what you'll see. They've pretty well eaten up the whole bulk of the material, and it's just left bits of stem and seed head in the ground that they've been feeding on. And that's exactly what we expect to see and want to see, with the seed being pushed into the tread marks where they've been. And then later on in the spring, if it's worked, then again, there's more evidence to follow. If you see these little seedlings coming up in the patches of bare ground that the process has left. So the trampling and the grazing, and Ollie stressed this, that the grazing is crucial if you're going to suppress the grass sufficiently to give these tiny little plantlets a good chance of establishing and surviving. If all that grass was still there shading and smothering them, then not much would be able to come through. This is an increasing problem in these milder winters that we seem to be getting now. The grass around here, certainly in the milder winter climates of Morecambe Bay, seems to keep growing for most of the winter. So unless we have some means for just restraining it, restricting it, then it's going to be a continuing problem for establishing herbs. One problem with this system is that supplementary feeding is not permitted in most agri-environment scheme prescriptions. We've managed to get around that under the HLS agreements that we have, but I think it might be more difficult under the new countryside stewardship IATEA system. It doesn't have to make a mess, and so you've seen the process underway. This is the kind of situation where we first got the idea for this way of doing things. It's Chancellor's Farm, Somerset Wildlife Trust Reserve, on the Mendips, where we had the privilege of living and working for a few years back in the 80s. And the system there, we heard from people who'd known the farm, was that the stock were outwintered, the hay was cut, and it was stored in these groves of sycamore, and then just put out on the fields each winter for the cattle to eat up. So it produced these wonderfully herb-rich meadows, which are SSSI and something that we felt we could emulate and use. Not all meadow restoration, however, needs to be based on mowing. And this example comes from a National Nature Reserve nearby called Gate Barrows. It's a mixture of damp and drier ground, quite species rich as it is now. It hasn't been mown for the last 25 years, but the communities there are probably the most typical MG5, you know, the unimproved lowland hay meadow that we have in this area. And they've just developed purely on the basis of the fact that it's being grazed in an appropriate manner. The key here is that the grazing doesn't start till the 1st of July, which is late enough to allow most of the key species to have set at least some seed. The stocking rate is low, so you know, not everything disappears on the 1st of July when the cattle goes in. It takes a long while for the bulk of it to get eaten up. And most plant species get to seed, including the hay rattle, which was there in one small area at the start of this whole process. And we were able to observe the spread of the hay rattle across, it's about 30 acres of unimproved grassland, very grassy at the start. The hay rattle advances, and then all these other flowers have literally followed in the wake of the hay rattle, including our old favourite, the Northern Marsh Orchid. So, you know, I just wish if we'd known that was going to be the story, we could have collected some data to describe it in a bit more detail. But for now, all we've got is my memory of it. By the end of the grazing period, late November, December, everything has been eaten off. And so this is what it looks like at that stage. All the flowers, all the seed heads, all the bulk has been gone, has been removed. And it's equivalent, I would say, to what you might like most hay meadows to look like. And if they've been cut and aftermath grazed, they would probably still look something quite similar to this. If there is a bit more tussock and stemmy material left, then we can justify that by saying it's quite good for the invertebrates and the small mammals. So you basically a suggestion that meadows don't have to be mown, but if you get the grazing management right, you can get a good endpoint that way. Just a couple of things about maintenance. We've heard a lot about weeds, and you know, this is my worst experience with weeds, docks, wall to wall in this. This is the one example we have of a reseed. It was force majeure. We didn't have much choice. The land had to be ploughed had to be dug up to relay the soak away from adjoining septic tanks. You can see the bungalow at the bottom. So we reseeded it with a bought-in seed mix, and where we didn't have enough to reseed, the docks took over. Sorry, I've gone the wrong way. So it's a question of, because we're organic, we can only pull or dig the docks, which we did. We set about it, not with any great enthusiasm or confidence, but in the end, it has worked. And that picture was taken this year after about, I think, 7 or 8 years of consistently going. Now, I would argue that whilst that sounds onerous, it's actually, from our point of view, it's been quite good, because you can't go and do that job without really getting, you know, up close and personal with that plant community. And so, you know, it's given us, even though we haven't got quadrat data, we could tell quite well how the thing was changing. And a lot of the oxeye daisy that you see in that's disappeared now. It's become sort of much less colourful, but much richer in terms of the species it contains. Molehills are another problem. If the soil gets in the bales, then the stock don't like it, and they get wasted. So we have to go around in the spring and level any molehills, but moles don't restrict their activity to the winter months. They come up in the summer as well. And then we have to go and actually take out the soil with a spade and remove it if we don't want it to end up in the bales. On the other hand, these molehills do provide some very good sites for seeding, particularly things like hay rattle in, if you want to avoid these other routes. Lastly, this is to end with a beginning. I'm sticking this in really just to be controversial. It's a self-generating meadow, and it's basically arrived because of what we do. So this is a big area of limestone grassland on Whitbarrow, which is a National Nature Reserve managed by the Forestry Commission. So they felled the trees and built this barn so we would have somewhere to store the hay to feed the cattle when it was snowy like this. In doing that, the pen around it was stoned with quarry bottoms. So it started off as bare ground. All we've done is gather the cattle in there when we need to, move them off site. We've trailed through carrying bales of hay, brought the hay back out. So it's simply a natural byproduct of everything we've done. And it's that bare stone has gone to species rich grassland in the space of about 10 years, which now I realize that it's happened to me is a fascinating thing. There's about 2 centimeters of new soil in that bare ground. And it should be a reminder to us all of what this system actually involves. I've actually been able to send a sample of the soil to have it analyzed, and it's over 30% organic matter. And so in this time of climate crisis, I think that's a really important lesson. So this whole exercise, we need to remember that it's more than just about restoring nice looking meadows. There are some bigger questions that we would hope to be able to contribute to. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Bill. That was fascinating. I just wanted to pick up on a question from Susanna Carter. Do you use this method all winter? I presume she's referring to the method of putting piles of hay out for livestock, i.e. do your livestock come in at all during winter?
We do have housing probably for a maximum of 8 or 10 animals, but with somewhere between 150 and 200, you know, it's obvious that most of them have to be out for most of the time. So that housing space is just reserved for the elderly and the less firm, the less sound animals, and anything that needs to come in as a sort of emergency. So we produced a little bit of farmyard manure, which obviously goes back on the meadows once it's composted down.
Great. Okay. Thank you very much, Bill. So now we're going to go to Fidelity in Kent. You're going to share your screen. Hang on. Slide. Okay, can you all hear me, everybody? I hope so. I think I'm off mute. Can you hear me, Phoebes? Yeah. Hello, everybody. I'm just going to do a quick whip through an experiment that we've done at Rumshed Farm from over the last 10 to 12 years. And I just want to start off with this picture here, because we had basically took 3 fields and we treated them in different ways to see which was the best way of reintroducing wildflowers. So in this near field where the cattle are, that was a picture taken last year. This is the field which I'll be talking about a little bit later on, where we simply spread yellow rattle seed across it. It's a very small 2-acre paddock. Then the bright green field that you can see in the middle of the photograph there is our second field, which was just a field which we decided we'd just manage as a traditional hay meadow, with manuring every now and again, not very often at all, and basically taking hay most years. And then over the top is the field I'm going to start with, which we started with a brand new reseed for various reasons. So starting with that field with the tractor in it, Phoebe's doing the slides for me. I think I just wanted to preface this chat with just saying that for us at Rumshed, probably the biggest change that started happening to our meadows was when we converted to organic in 2000 and took nitrogen. We stopped putting synthetic nitrogen on the farm. And over the following 10 years, we suddenly saw, well, we didn't suddenly see, we gradually saw lots of species coming back that we simply hadn't had before because we were using the fertilizer. So that for us was a wonderful first step. And it was going into high-level stewardship about 10 years ago that we decided we'd take this extra step and just have a bit more of a play around with how we could actually maybe speed up the process. So this field here, which is the first I'm going to start with, was a field that we totally denuded of any nutrients because we'd grown organic cereals very badly on it for a number of years. We hadn't replenished the soils, so we'd taken all the nutrients out of it. We'd been running pigs on it for quite a few years. We're heavy, heavy clay soils, and the field was totally trashed and looked terrible with docks all over it, thistles, everything you can imagine. So we felt we wanted to put it back into something special. So the decided that at that time there was a meadows initiative called the Weald Meadows Initiative, which was based in Sussex, which is not far from us. We're in Kent, just over on the west of Kent. And they were basically looking for donor sites which they could match up to sites from fields that they were taking seed from. So the first thing we felt we were going to have to tackle, and this is answers, I think, a few of the questions that have popped up on the Q&A, is dealing with the docks and the thistles. To be honest with you, I might do this again now, given the infestation we had, but I wouldn't choose to. But we went to the Soil Association, said we wanted to put this piece of land back into a wildflower meadow, that we wouldn't be able to manage it on organic basis going forward because it was so infested with docks and thistles. And could we have a derogation to take it out of organic for one day in order to spray it and then put it back into organic again? And they said, yes, we could. So in order to get rid of the docks and thistles, we gave it a spray. We then treated this field terribly classically in those days about putting in, you know, nice new grass lay. We ploughed it, we spread the seed, and then we rolled it in with the tractor. Now, the seed that we bought was from this project, the Weald Meadows Initiative, which, as I say, they had chosen a field that they felt was as good for our field as they could do. When we put the seed on the field, it was said to have got 70 to 80 different species in it. It's now got nearer to 40 species in it. And a lot of those species that were said to have come with the seed never materialized at all. We never saw any of them. So I think that's one interesting lesson about moving seed. We rolled it all in, and then within a year, we were totally dismayed by what we saw. Basically, the whole field was just covered in mayweed. It looked absolutely dreadful and seemed like it would have been a complete failure. We did a token gesture of going down to Marden Meadow, which is a SSSI down in the Weald of Kent, run by the Kent Wildlife Trust. They were cutting hay, and we filled up our livestock trailer with a load of green hay and spread that in one particular place on the field so I could monitor exactly where that had gone. And in fact, the very next year, we had orchids come up, which have come up most years since, but not every year. So I think my message about this slide is don't lose heart, because this next slide, which I'm going to show you, shows you what the field looked like probably 3 or 4 years in. You've got Dyer's greenweed there in the centre of the photograph, which is that yellow plant and quite unusual. Tons of oxide daisies, which made it look beautiful, but also loads of other things coming in, the vetches, the trefoils, all the different grass species, the knapweed. It was just sensational and terribly, terribly beautiful. So over the years, we've continued to take hay off every single year and graze it. I've covered the business about being organic, but I would concur with Bill that an essential task for us in the early stages was pulling docks every year. And luckily we had lots of young people very happy and willing to earn some money. I have to say we've eased off this in the last 5 years and probably should do it again. Pulling docks can be hard work, and in our heavy clay soils, if we want to get the roots out, we need to go with the right season. And frankly, hard, dry summers don't help pull up docks. We need a nice moist summer to do that, but otherwise we've managed it very conventionally with cattle, sheep grazing it and making the hay. Next photo, please. And so this is how it looks. This is how it looked last year. So you can see how much has changed from that second or third photograph that I showed you. The oxidases have gone. The Dyer's greenweed is still there. And we still continue to find new species as we go through the fields each year. Not necessarily there every year, but we think we're up to, we've counted 38 different species in that field. So that looks beautiful and we're incredibly proud of it and love it. And you walk into the field in the summer and it is just a sound, this insect sound is unbelievable. It sounds like the south of France. So moving on now to the second one, which is in the far bit of this photograph I've got here. There we are just doing what I'd call conventional haymaking, pretty big machinery. That year we had very wet summers. So in fact, we didn't even make hay, we made it into haylage. And that field over the last 10 years, the species has definitely increased. We've had some lovely plants come in, one of my favourite ones, which is grass fetchlings. But it's much, much slower than the other field. And if you compared the two, the diversity in the middle field is nothing compared to the one in the first field. And interestingly, one of the things we've realised is that the yellow rattle moves around the farm all over the place, but it has actually never, ever moved into that field. So it's work in progress and quite slow, but nevertheless, still rewarding and still changing. So if we now look at this berry, the field in front, and that's Martin, my husband, when we sort of broke our rules on that field, because we did actually spread a bit of green hay in one half of it, which again, we could monitor compared to the other half, because we didn't feel the change was happening quick enough. But basically, as Phoebe was showing you on the next slide, this was the field that one summer after we'd taken the hay, I bought 1 kilogram of yellow rattle and I just walked across the field, chucking it down, trotted in with the sheep. And I think maybe key to getting yellow rattle going is the following spring is to keep the grass very well nibbled in February and March. So there's little competition from that new seed from the grasses. And this is what the field looked like that summer and the year after. There was just not, there was hardly a single blade of grass in the field. So clearly we had way overdone it. But the interesting thing, and this responds to one of the questions I think somebody sent through earlier on, which is that it does in the end come to a balance. So as the next photograph will show, over the years, the following years, the first of all, actually the red clover came in. So I was really interested to see hear what Bill was saying about red clover coming in. The two plants that came in were red clover and sorrel, loads of it. And now this is what that field has sort of settled down to. Basically grasses, there's lesser stitch work there. There's the vetches and trefoils that we've got on some of the other fields. Lots of sorrel and plenty of red and white clover turned up. So that's the story of our three meadows. I would say that probably the second two are fairly comparable after 10 years. The yellow rattle is doing its job in this field and it's moved through into some of the other paddocks. And as Bill pointed out, one thing we've noticed is that when the yellow rattle does go into another field, there often follows a really nice little flurry of new species that come into those fields. The yellow rattle might then move on and carry on through. So that's what the field looked like. The next slide shows another sample of what our classic meadows are like now at Rumshed. And finally, the concluding slide, Phoebe, which is the last one, is basically saying that the key things that we feel for getting diversity back into your meadows is, first of all, take off all synthetic nitrogen, just stop putting it on. You'll be dismayed when you first do that for the first few years. We had a terribly low hay crop, but we worked really hard at encouraging the clovers to come naturally in the fields by rolling them in the spring, which is what they like. And after about 3 or 4 years, those started doing the job of fixing the nitrogen into the soils. And by year 4 and 5, we were getting the same crops as we would have done, same quantity of crops as we would have done if we'd used nitrogen fertilizer. It does take longer to produce a crop on that basis, but nevertheless, it can be done. And the other things that are totally essential is being able to make hay and graze your sheep and cattle on them. Thank you very much, everyone. Great, thanks Fidelity. Thank you to everyone, that was very interesting. And we've had, our panellists have been very busy answering questions, so they've already got through 37 of them, which is great because actually in the end our presentations went quite a long time over. So we've only got 15 minutes of questions. So I am going to start with a question that I was sent via email. So this is from Sheila Yeomans in Mid Wales. We have about an acre of meadow, used to be sheep grazing until 8 years ago, and have so far coped with bramble, bracken and gorse invasion from the edges. But this year there is a lot of hogweed. What is the best way to deal with this, please? I cut a lot of it before it flowered and dried and burnt it. I've seen suggestions to dig it out before May. It grows in the hedges and in adjacent unmanaged fields, so the problem will not go away. I don't know who's best placed to answer that question.
Well, no one else. We have a problem with it here too. My own take is because it is a nutritious plant in its own right, then we're not going to worry too much if it establishes up to a certain point. Beyond that, I'm not sure what we would do. But at current levels, I think we're prepared to live with it because A, it's a it's a good fodder plant, and B, when it flowers, it's very good for pollinators. I don't know what Fidelity and Ollie think about that.
I would agree with Bill there, to be honest, I think. But there's probably more questions we would need to ask, really, going back to the lady who's asked the question, because we don't know how bad that infestation is. It may well be fairly minor, as Bill said. And we don't know whether she's grazing the field or not, because often, you know, grazing over a period of time can start to reduce the dominance of some of these species. So getting the kind of management going in a meadow, a long-term management, and these problem plants often are a long-term sort of proposition to get them under some sort of control. I think everyone hopefully would agree with that it's not necessarily a quick fix, but, you know, cutting it before it seeds is one way of trying to reduce the seed burden. And getting some later grazing in as well can be beneficial. So, and we have actually got some guidance around hogweed control that we can post into the, I don't know if Phoebe's done that already, but.
I'll just post that in, but generally speaking, it's such a valuable plant. It's an interesting one, hogweed, because it's decent fodder. It's also amazing for invertebrates. Mm-hmm. So it's all about the extent of the problem, really, and I think in severe cases we probably would recommend moving the cut potentially slightly earlier, or a topping, maybe even in June, at least a partial topping to try and reduce the seed load of that plant for that season. Feel free to send us photos so we can get a sense of the balance of the species in your meadow and whether, you know, we can help advise on those sorts of interventions.
And would say that it's very common, isn't it, across lots of meadows, across lots of parts of the country. You know, it's often a component of a meadow, as I think
especially
it's
really sort of alluded to. Especially if you've got thick hedgerow and waysides. Yeah.
I just wanted to pop in there because I think that's a really interesting point. So I've spent quite a lot of hours cutting hogweed to stop it seeding into our meadows. But just recently, and I suppose it's the experience of NEP and the feeling now that we should all be encouraging scrub and letting our hedgerows spill over more into our meadows. And my approach, I think, is to be much more laissez-faire. I feel more laissez-faire even about the docks than I did a few years ago. And I don't know if that's a change that everyone's feeling, that we, you know, we need to stop being quite so precious about containing things and maybe just letting the natural processes go. So I suppose I'd say to that lady, possibly let yourself have some areas like that and maybe bring in grazing and find that you get nice species rich plants coming elsewhere. You've got a whole variety and hogweed is an acceptable part of that variety. I fully accept you try to make hay with it, it's not, but I think we maybe have to change our approach to weeds.
I think if the lady would like to drop us a line with some images and we can have a chat with her about it and just ask a few more questions, and maybe we can try and help support her a bit more through that. So,
great. Great, thanks everyone for that. I'm just going to quickly group three questions for Fidelity that have come in on the Q&A. So is that haylage you're making in the square bales? When do you spread the yellow rattle? And what P levels are you starting with?
So the answer is it was haylage we made that year. Our preference is always to try and make hay if we can, but even in the southeast, we sometimes have summers when we just don't get enough days and the contractor can't come at the right time, so we end up wrapping it into haylage. And the big disadvantage for that is that you don't get any of the seed over the winter. It seems to kill off the seed and is no good trying to think you can introduce some nice diversity into your meadows that way. The P levels in that field, I can't remember, but I think there would have been one. So they were very low, and we took great care at getting everything analysed, and the project that was supplying us with the seed was also keen to make sure we got all that right. And the hay, the yellow rattle, we spread that immediately after we'd taken the hay crop. So it would have been July, end of July. We spread it and then we immediately put the sheep in to trample it into the ground, because one of the things about hay rattle is that you do want to make sure it's like a it's a very flat seed, like parsnip seed, and you want to make sure that it makes contact with the soil. So if you can get it out, get it down as soon as the hay crop's off, so the sward is still open, and then put some sheep in it or cattle, I think that's probably your best chance of getting it going.
And the other thing with hay rattle is that because it's a germinator of the, it germinates in the springtime, so keeping that grass down over the autumn and the later part of the winter, if it's possible to graze quite late. And of course that is very variable depending on where you are in the country and how wet it is, because you don't want to damage or compact your soil by grazing it when it's very wet. But in an ideal world, you want to try and keep that grass as short as possible, so there's enough light for the germination of that rattle, and there's enough, you know, the sward is open enough in the spring for that to germinate. And that's partly why rattle becomes so dominant in these hay meadows that have that combination of hay cutting and then that very regular aftermath grazing, because you end up with a very open sward, which is perfect for hay rattle to just keep on reseeding and germinating year after year after year.
Great, thanks everyone for that. So one question by email from Mark. I intend to convert some low input permanent pasture into a far more species rich sward. The pasture has been in situ for circa 60 years. Species rich seed is expensive, and so I want success. Plough reseed or a glyphosate kill seem to offer the greatest success, but I appreciate the harm these two methods involve. Is there an undisputed successful alternative to glyphosate? I'm currently not convinced that stitching a new seed after heavy grazing and surface disturbance on an old leg will have medium long-term success due to the very robust sward in place. Any thoughts that tell warts and all would be appreciated.
Phoebe, go on, you answer that one.
Please send us some pictures of your there's a lot of free advice out there for the people in exactly this situation from Wildlife Trust, from Plant Life, from Natural England. It would be really good to understand like what you're using the site for, what you need to get out of that site in terms of the productivity, and what you want to achieve, but also what you've currently got. And there may be some very straightforward alternatives to glyphosate and reseed. Or it might be a case, depending on what you want to produce on that land, really. Pasture for Life would have also some advice about options around organic herbal lay, etc. But we would be quite keen to understand if it aligned with your objectives, whether we could work with the existing sward to diversify that, probably through slightly naturalistic techniques, albeit we're not against the use of spot spraying or the use of some soil disturbance if that is really required to open up the sward on compacted soils, for example, to deal with pernicious species. All of these really tricky issues can be dealt with pragmatically. Conservationists should not tell you no. They should say there's a range of options. And the best way to give you that range of options is to understand more about what you want from the site and the current vegetational composition and soil condition on your site.
I think that's why it's really important that we sort of set out at the outset knowing as much as you possibly can about the site, about the fertility of the soil, about the species that may be present or not present in an existing piece of grassland, because there may well be, if that pasture has been pastured for that length of time, and of course knowing and understanding the past management and the past inputs that may have been in that site obviously will give us a better a better way to try and direct you to the right, you know, possible solution to what you're trying to do. So I think we'd need more information really to answer that question properly.
Could I just chip in?
Absolutely, yeah. Bill.
Just that, you know, more and more evidence is accumulating all the time about how harmful glyphosate particularly is. It's an antibiotic. It's been patented as an antibiotic. And so it will severely alter the whole soil microbiome if you use it, especially in that sort of wholesale way. The damage will obviously be much less if you're using it to spot spray. But I think it's high time that we really began to think our way out of the chemical box. And, you know, if a 60-year-old grassland that's not been well managed, you know, it can look a very daunting prospect. But I think it would be an admission of defeat if we had to go back to something like glyphosate to just start the whole process again, because you'd be starting at a place which was sort of already below zero from having to use that chemical and the way it interacts with the soil.
I think we would both very much concur with Bill's point there as well. That's really, really useful to raise that.
I'm from Natural England, as a Natural England chap on the call called Paul, and he's really happy to talk to that person. So if we can somehow find a way to swap contacts, I'm not sure how that's possible.
I can pass Paul's details on to Mark. And just one last question, we've got 3 minutes left. From Nikki Gething, I spread hay from a SSSI meadow onto a donor field about 2 weeks ago. I'm worried this dry, scorching weather may affect the success of the spread. What are your thoughts?
Pray for rain.
It might. You're absolutely right. Weather, you know,
it's a variable situation, isn't it? I mean, basically, once you've put this stuff down, you kind of are slightly in the lap of the gods with what happens. I mean, last year people were very concerned about the wet weather, and they were sowing wildflower meadows in far from ideal conditions, sometimes into November, in very wet conditions, and they had some success.
I think that's the key thing. Yeah. With expectation management, recognising that there'll probably be something that will come up, but droughting, additional rainfall, actually these very warm winters are actually making it quite tricky for quite a lot of species to germinate because it doesn't get cool enough. So, for example, yellow rattle sowing that I did last year wasn't very good this year in Wales, particularly areas of coastal Wales where it's got that sea air, lots of humidity, and the temperatures just didn't get cold enough, so we didn't see a lot of that germinate. And everything about meadow management is patience, probably, is the first and biggest ingredient that you need with this sort of thing. So you're quite right in your observation of the weather and how it might affect your outcome. We'd encourage you to do it again next year if the outcomes aren't great, if that's possible.
But the likelihood is you probably will get some germination, and as long as you start to get some of those wildflowers in your meadow, you know, it's just as Phoebe said, it's the patience, it's the time, and then it's committing to that ongoing management that ultimately is going to reap the rewards, I think, in the long term. So but yeah, I mean, I suppose green hay also is a variable product. It's not like buying a commercial seed mix, which has all been carefully dried and cleaned off the shelf. You know, so inevitably it's going to be variable, and it will do what it does to some extent. Bill, do you want to come in and say something about that?
Just that it's kind of beyond my experience. You know, the way we've done things is as far as possible to keep away from having to do the active reseeding, and we've had the luxury of doing this over such a long period of time, mm-hmm. of just getting on with the farming and letting nature fill in whatever spaces it wants to find. And so my take on it is that as long as you're doing the right things at more or less the right time, and in more or less the right order, then, you know, eventually nature will do her job too.
Just thank you, everyone. Just one question. I know I said that was the last one, but just one more I want to pick on from Peter Gurney saying, is Red Bartizer? Pronouncing that terribly. Is it a worthwhile grass parasite?
It's a worthwhile plant in lots of ways, Red Bartizer. It's all flowering at the moment across the UK, isn't it? It is semi-parasitic on grass. It's generally found on waysides, trackways, compressed areas. So it's, you can find it in the middle of a meadow, but slightly less likely. It's to be encouraged, absolutely.
Okay, great. We've had a few more questions come through, but unfortunately, we won't have time to get round to them all. We did a lot better than last time. I think we had about 80 unanswered questions. So thank you very much to the panellists, not only for giving really interesting talks with really brilliant slideshow presentations, but also answering so many questions during the event. Thanks to everyone for coming. It's been really interesting. I hope you've learned a lot. And this will be put on YouTube, I think, tomorrow, and it'll be sent out to everyone. So if for any reason you haven't been able to make it, or you know people who'd be interested in this, please send them the YouTube video so it can get to as many people as possible. We will be back with our next webinar next month, which, as I mentioned very briefly at the beginning, it's going to be talking about a similar thing but on smaller scale, so on gardens and verges. So if you think you have people that would be interested in that, do let them know. Thanks very much for watching, and have a lovely evening. Thanks to all the panelists. Bye.